Hello everybody,
Hello.
Thank you for organizing such a program, and as the reactions also is coming even before we start the program, I think that itself is evident of relevance of such a program. And I think that we have to start with that point also in this larger framework where we are holding this discussion. So I think that the reaction was also anticipating what we are going to say. So actually we have to start with that thing itself, that it is now it is 2.5 months of the total lockdown, and the total insensitivity and the cruel negligence to the healthcare system, entire healthcare system in the country, and the healthcare workers and the workers, working class and the working people of the country from the ruling classes. And when we start about this thing, about the entire healthcare system where we are placed, I will speak about the scheme workers, the ASHA workers and the other scheme workers who are working on this, fighting this COVID. So in the entire system of, in the entire health system, especially the public health system, which was fighting all the other ailments except for the COVID. And then suddenly the COVID and this pandemic came. So we have to deal with the entire COVID situation and the pandemic. Now what is happening, that the entire health system is totally dealing with the only the COVID pandemic. And for that particular purpose was this lockdown was declared. And what is happening is that except for that work, the other things have happened, only this thali and all these things happened. And this lockdown was actually to buy time to make all the arrangements for dealing with the pandemic. And I'm not going into details about that and what happened and all, but what was supposed to be done by a government, all the governments, except for in Kerala, the state governments and even the central governments, not to say much about, that is totally a failure of the any kind of healthcare for the people of the country. They were supposed to have more facility for tests, PPEs and masks and sanitizers, and also for arranging for the quarantine for the people. So this is a total failure. And because even our health care system is a total public health care system, it should have been much more strengthened. And we can see that what was the announcement, except for the announcement which came in April, around 15,000 crores to strengthen the entire healthcare system, there is no concrete package or no concrete even announcement from the part of the government for strengthening all this entire system. So this is a question of the entire right of healthcare for the people of the country. There comes the arrangements where we are having a whole range of public healthcare system, the hospitals and that network, and the private healthcare system and all. And here in the public healthcare system, where these ASHA workers, which Susanna was mentioning, they are placed in actually the ASHAs were recruited in the National Health Mission, which was supposed to be, the mission was to, mission means that it is for a short term and then you can manage the short time requirements, and then you are supposedly having a permanent system, which is okay. But this was also a kind of a cheating of the people's health requirements, this health mission. So this was so the entire design of this National Health Mission itself was a kind of a not actually what is required, but it showbazi or whatever you can call, because the demand for the healthcare was there, but the government didn't really want to give healthcare, so the entire health mission, but the demands and the public pressure was there. So there, these they are at the bottom, ASHA workers are at the bottom line of the entire hierarchy. So they there you can see all the other kind of workers are supposedly employees or workers, but the ashas by design itself, they are not considered as the workers or employees, and they are supposedly volunteers. So there I want to say that in the entire design itself, this entire concept of scheme workers in the anganwadi workers in the nutritional care and the child care and preschool education and all, and even in the other sectors also, the entire concept of scheme workers is coming out of the concept of the entire utilization of the social norms of the unpaid care work. So there the women are supposed to do entire family care work, taking care of the health requirements, primary health requirements also. So that is extended to the society in this scheme and exploited by the government itself. And you can see that they are even not giving paid a permanent, means the monthly remuneration. They are piece rate workers, ASHA workers. And as per the government of India, they are supposedly getting 2,000 rupees per month. That also recently started. This earlier it was 1,000 per month, but even this 2,000 rupees which the government announced in 2018, even today many states they are not getting that. So in that situation they work, and in the COVID situation, the government declared it as pandemic. From the very first day, the ASHA workers were put on duty, and as of now we can see that the entire healthcare system is now concentrating on fighting this COVID. And in that, the major part of the work of preventing it as a community spread, that is being done by these ASHA workers. And in addition to the ASHA workers, the Anganwadi workers are also recruited for helping them and controlling the pandemic, and as the community health workers. They are, from the first day itself, they were supposedly taking care of, means collect the information is of anybody is having the disease, anybody is having fever, cough, everything like that. That from that report on the house to house survey they were conducting and informing the government, informing the health system, and then reporting and talking to them, motivating them and educating the people. This kind of work is there. And then after the thing, then they were recruited for the quarantine centers. They were given duty in the quarantine centers, and ASHA workers primarily, and in additionally Anganwadi workers also were doing the same kind of work. In the second phase, the Anganwadi workers also were asked to perform all these duties. So here we can see that, as the in the introduction we said, that the entire emotional, then the physical, all this strain and the duties and the entire situation has been created of a fear in the society also. So there these people were put in the front line to fight, means deal with the society. The rest of the people either dealing with those who are having the illness or their disease they are dealing with, but these people, the Anganwadi and the ASHA workers mainly, they are dealing with the people who are having all kinds of the other problems also. So they are directly dealing with the people. So here the problem of the ASHA workers and these Anganwadi workers and the frontline workers. And I would like to say that in the National Health Mission, it is not only the ASHA workers, but there are a whole range of kind of workers, including the doctors who are not permanent getting an honorarium, and then the 108 ambulance workers, other kind of workers, all they are all having the similar kinds of problems of the working conditions. Here the main concern is the safety. The in nowhere the ASHA workers were given properly, even at least I can say that 80% of the ASHA workers are not getting any mask or soap or sanitizer, not to say about the PPE kits or anything. When they are asked to perform their duties in the red zone or containment zone, etc., and they are even they are asked to do work in the hospitals. They are paying out of their pocket for purchasing the masks and sanitizers kind of things, and then in their payment, which is so meager an amount, which is they are supposedly getting. In a recent survey, around 69% of the workers, they are not getting their payment for the last 5 to 6 months. And then whatever is government announced is an additional remuneration of 1,000 rupees. There was a big bang about their role, their corona warriors and ASHA workers, their role and all. These things are coming in Twitter. But and an announcement and an order has came. But the ASHA workers, 75% of the ASHA workers were not paid this additional remuneration. Then the additional problem what they face is the attack from the community. One is that the fear psychosis is there, and they are termed as the carriers of corona because they go from door to door. So they were attacked in many places in Karnataka, in Haryana and Punjab. Immediately I can say examples, and their family members even attacked. That one in Haryana, when the girl child of an ASHA worker has to be hospitalized for days together because of the attack. One is that they are spreading this thing, and the other one is that they are reporting that. Why should you report about my disease? So that people who were being reported about corona, they also, their family and also attacked the ASHA workers. These kind of problems are there. Then the question, or crucial question, now it is coming in large numbers. You can see the stories of the doctors and nurses and all are getting affected and dying, that is also coming. And you can see that even ASHA workers and also Anganwadi workers who have got COVID infection and deaths are also reported. Deaths are reported from UP, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Maharashtra of ASHA workers and Anganwadi workers. And from Andhra Pradesh, there was a report yesterday. We had a meeting, and then 15 cases of death. And here what is happening is that in many cases of death, even the postmortem and the corona test is not being conducted. So what is the government has announced for these people? One is that 1,000 rupees for the ASHA workers. For the other workers, there is no announcement. That is what is called this PM Kalyan Yojana. This is Kalyan for the PM only. So that this PM Kalyan Yojana, in that the announcement is for 50 lakh of insurance. It is not a means insurance for this coverage of this COVID or infection. It is a life insurance. Only if you die, you will get the money. So even in case of death, means who is going to confirm that it is out of COVID? Or the conditions are saying that you were asked to perform the COVID duty with the patient, that has to be proven to get this compensation. So in many of these cases, even the doctors are, I don't know how many of the people, the health sector workers are getting this compensation of 50 lakh in case, even in case of death. We got many cases of even Anganwadi and ASHA workers who died, and they are still fighting to get this compensation. And you can see the irony, this insurance what the government announced, it is not covering the treatment cost. It is not covering or any other kind of. And then what is crucially important is that these workers, ASHA workers, because of the COVID duty, they are not able to perform the other activities which they used to get payment for, the piece rates. So, and even in the health system, all those things are stopped. So there, their income is no more there. And now you cannot perform your own activities, and you are quarantined or you are under treatment, and your family also, entire family also will be under treatment. And there the pressure from the family also is there. So this is the situation. I'm not going into details about that because of paucity of time. But then the thing is that what we demand from our organization is that So one is that the permanent, our demands were there, that these are the people who are crucially giving the most valuable services for the society. A society like India needs such kind of a permanent system. So the NHM has to be made permanent, and the ASHA workers, who are the key people who are working for the as community health workers, they have to be made permanent. And then that demand is there continuing. And then now what our demand is, that first and foremost is about the safety equipment, sanitizers, all these things, and who are doing duty in the red and containment area, and also having regular checkup for the for COVID test has to be performed in a regular basis for all the health workers and also the frontline workers. That is a demand from the trade unions, that at least once a month COVID test has to be performed. And then for the additional remuneration, we demand around ₹25,000 for all the scheme workers and the contract workers who are in the front line, at least in the health sector, we demand. And then for all the insurance scheme, you see that even in ASHA workers, everybody is not covered for this 50 lakh. As per the, when the Haryana government has notified that the doctors will get 50 lakh rupees and the ASHA workers will get 10 lakh rupees. Means in case of death, I am telling. So that kind of a differentiation and discrimination also is there in the health system in many places. So there we demand 50 lakh for all the frontline workers, plus an additional at least minimum 5 lakh rupees of compensation in case of infection, and the expenses for quarantine and all, and also to for the coverage of the family also, who are the government itself is putting us on duty, so that has to be done. And the testing I spoke about, and then we demand, means as the for the general, in general, this is not only the question of the healthcare workers and their service condition, it's the right of the people for a healthcare system. So it has to be, they have to increase the health sector spending of at least to up to 5% and improve the entire health system infrastructure, including everything. And then they have to withdraw the last budget they have, and in the Niti Aayog proposal of privatization of the entire public healthcare system was proposed. Even now, nothing is spoken about that. Even in countries like developed capitalist countries, they are publicizing the private healthcare also. So now we demand that proposal to be withdrawn, and the health system has to be strengthened, and a legislation for the right to healthcare has to be brought. That is one of our demands, major demands, and ₹7,500 for the families and all. And I would like to mention about some of our struggles also, because it is not that we have just put this demand and sitting idle. There has been struggles even during this lockdown. The workers at the grassroots level on the workplace also, they raised the issues. Even yesterday in Haryana, the ASHA workers had a 2-hour strike. In Madhya Pradesh, the ASHA workers in Indore and all, you know that the kind of situation there, they had a strike and then they got some more compensation and facilities there. In Madhya Pradesh, they had the struggle. Throughout the country, in Andhra Pradesh, everywhere, all the states, they are having the struggles. And all over India, from the CITU, we have given a call for a right on this enough of flowers, we want safety. That was the slogan. On 14th of May, we had a major struggle. Around 4 lakh workers participated in that. And now, with the ASHA Workers Coordination Committee, we met yesterday, because the increasing cases of infection and deaths is there. So we have given a call for 25th of June. We are going to observe a demand day, and in which we would like to request all the other health sector workers also to join. And in the coming days, I think this is going to be a major struggle. It's a right, not only the right of the health sector workers, including the doctors and up to the SSFI Karmacharis and the scheme workers, but it's the right of the people. People at large are not getting any system. You know that the situation in Delhi and also. So it has to be a big movement to pressurize the government to make adequate allocation and spending to improve the healthcare system, public healthcare system, and have a control over the private profiteering. So I think I can finish now.
Thank you very much, Amrit Singh. I think you've really located the discussion about decent work for healthcare workers within the question of the right to health, and shown how many of the issues that we see today are actually building up on issues that have been long time issues. The inadequacy of the payment of ASHA workers that was kind of already built into the NRHM, and that is now also showing up in terms of complete inadequacy of the kind of remuneration that is given. I think everyone has noted the date of the 23rd of June as a day where solidarity with the ASHA workers unions will be very important. Let's go to the next speaker, Comrade Surya. You have been working with Union of Class 4 workers in public hospitals. So that includes, for instance, sanitation workers, security workers, the attendants and helpers in the wards, ambulances or laboratories. This is really a category of workers that we don't hear much about in the media. There is less information in the public domain about what is happening with them. Working conditions today. There is an understanding, of course, that there is a problem with contractualization, minimum wage not being paid. But can you tell us more about what are the issues that they are facing during this pandemic, and what are the kind of steps that need to be taken and the demands that your union has put forward to improve the situation? You are on mute. You have to unmute.
Yes. Am I audible now? Okay, now. Hello. I will be sharing my experience from what I had from three hospitals of Delhi. We have union in one of the primary hospitals, Dr. RML Hospital, that Kalavati Saran Children Hospital, which is attached to the Lady Harding Medical College. And these two are central government hospitals. And the third is Satyavadi Raja Harishchand Hospital. That is a COVID center. This Satyavadi Raja Harishchand Hospital is a dedicated COVID center of Delhi government located in Narela. Now, my whole experience will be based on these hospitals. And similar is the condition in other... at other places also. Now, basically, we deal with the contract employees. As you know that in the months due to this privatization, liberalization, globalization, the whole this kind of work means the sanitation, security, attendant, even lab work have been outsourced. See, basically, the government says that these are the work of non-perennial nature. This is totally wrong. All these are perennial in nature. A hospital cannot run without sanitation. A hospital cannot run without security guard or attendants. A hospital cannot work without lab officials. So how can the government say that these are non-perennial? Means you can understand the intention behind government. Government only wants to pay lip service, wants to misguide the public that we are having big buildings, few doctors, but it is not laying emphasis on these aspects of like labs, sanitation workers, security guards. Despite they are one of the most important pillars of the healthcare system. Now I'll go some with point wise. See, two class of worker I will be dealing primarily among the fourth grade, that is sanitation staff and the security guard. These are the categories of employees that are highest in number in any hospital. These contract employees. See, contract and contractual is are different word. So, contract employees are the employees who work through a contractor. Means a third party is there who is having contract with the government, and he provides manpower to provide those services. Now I am coming to the experience of RML Hospital and Kalathi Sen Hospital. At these places, these sanitation staff not only do the sanitation work, but they also do the laundry and porter, the work of porter, means transporting the bulk medicine from the storeroom to the wards, transporting the clothes, means dirty clothes or the clean clothes from the laundry. So these people are doing the work for which they have not been hired. Means in spite of doing their primary work, they are being forced to do the other work because of the precarious situation. When we took this matter to the court, as see, courts are not very sympathetic to the this class of worker. They are the management, means the government. The government gave an argument that, see, as we are facing a shortage of employees, we need to make up through someone. So we need we make through these sanitation workers for our shortage. So these are totally means bogus. These are totally bogus means logics. Means you basically take the benefit of their precarious condition. Now, what are the issue faced by them? I am going point wise. They are not even paid the statutory minimum wages. In Kalathi Sen Hospital, means near the heart of Delhi, they are getting 10,000 rupees per month. You can imagine, that's around 323 or 300 something rupee means per day. Earlier they were getting even 200 something. So that's totally means illogical thing. As per the central government now, it's around 624 or 620, the minimum wages, current minimum wages per day. And remember, these employees are technically daily wage workers. So if they take it off and off, they will not be paid any wages for that. See, to get at 10,000 rupees a month, they need to come 30 or 30 meals for each and every day of the month without any leave or off. So this is a very bad condition. Means they are totally denied of the human and labor rights. Okay. Means they don't get any paid holiday. So if they take any kind of holiday or leave or off to get over the fatigue which they get, they will have to face the loss of income. No social security like EPF, ESIC to the sanitation workers in Dr. RML and Kalathi Sen Hospital is provided. RML is a PGIMER, means Postgraduate Institute of Medical Science and Research. From this year itself, it is also going to have 100 MBBS students. Lady Harding itself is one of the Center of Excellence of Government of India. So this is the condition at these hospitals, that these employees are not getting benefit of social security measures like Employee Provident Fund and ESIC. So if they face any means hazard or any kind of disease or any kind of disability, they want to be compensated. They want to be compensated. The ESIC hospitals won't be open to them. They are just at the mercy of these hospitals, that whether they treat them or not. And EPF means when they, if they manage to have work, means they are not fired by the contractor, or if they manage to work till 60, then also they won't be able to get any kind of pension after their retirement or any kind of lump sum amount.
So it totally means the whole means the healthcare system is sandbox. See, the healthcare doesn't only depends on the doctors itself. I do accept that doctors are one of the essential most part of the healthcare system, but the subordinate staff, the nursing staff, the lab technicians, the sanitation. You cannot run a hospital without sanitation work. No, it will be a contagious. It's not be a, then it won't be a proper hospital. So you need to means take proper care of these cases. But the government doesn't seem to pay any heed to this. The government is more means you are just paying a lip service that it to boost the morale. It is letting a plane or helicopter passing over the medical healthcare institution and showering the flower petals. But there was no any improvement in the condition of these class of workers. As these are not regular workers, and they are not even paid the minimum wages, they live in very poor conditions. What's that about poor condition, about their living condition? Now they are not getting the proper facilities in the hospital also, as they are the staff at the lowest rung. They don't have any changing room. They do change at the public places or in the toilets. Means after cleaning or something like that. They don't have canteen. Means they don't have any proper isolation. So the contamination of the whole system by them, the probability of contamination of the whole system by them increases too much. See, after a patient get admitted, a doctor did not to examine or come near to him physically every day. Means he need to see the reports or something like that. Means from that only he can monitor the medicine or the treatment procedure. But a sanitation worker need to means clean each and everything in the hospital. So these kind of workers are exposed in the highest manner, and despite being exposed in the highest manner, in the maximum manner, these are the most discriminated and overlooked class of workers. They are not screened regularly. They are not screened. So when you are not screening them, when you are not taking proper care of them, so not only these class of workers are at risk, but you are basically risking the whole society. Means they if any one of these get infected, as these the probability of getting infection is very high of this class of worker, they can spread the virus at their home or the place while commuting or their workplace. So basically you are the whole system is a leaking pot. You are the means the rhetoric of isolation, testing, and all these are means bogus terms. The reality is this: the whole system is a leaking pot, and you don't have any accountability. As these are sanitation workers and they are exposed in the means highest form. One more thing, that these sanitation workers from the lowest strata of the society, means in the caste structure. These are generally from the scheduled caste. As they are the poorly earning people and also from the lowest strata of the society, they are living in ghettos, means very poor areas. There also they are being discriminated, as already told by Comrade Sindhu, that they are being called as corona carriers. Means people do discriminate with them, even they face violence. one more thing, as they are the lowest rung workers, they are being discriminated in issue of sanitization products and PPE. Means the hospital management then feels that these sanitation workers need to be provided the PPEs and the sanitization products. Okay, now one more thing is few more things. See, as these workers, what happened that in Delhi there was notification that the doctors, if a doctors would be getting facility near to the hospital, in a hotel for quarantining themselves, or to means they will get an accommodation so that they don't spread the virus or they don't come in contact with other people. But this class of workers were not extended this facility. There was no any system in place for this class of worker. One more thing happened. What after the lockdown in the month of April, this class of workers were not able to go to the hospital. Most of them were not able to go to the hospital because they are so poor. They don't have any means of transport of their own, and the government didn't extended any kind of transportation system to them. But remember, the government was providing the transport system to the other class of employee, like nurses, like lab assistants, and permanent employee. But these kind of contract employees were not provided any kind of transport facility. Well, there is a fault of the government also, and there were also the notifications from the central government, means Home Ministry, that in case of absence due to COVID-19, due to pandemic, no salary of any employee would be deducted. But I'm telling you, the salaries of means around 500 employees who are working in Lady Harding and Calamity Sun Hospital as sanitation workers have been withheld. They have been not provided the salary for May. Anyhow, after ease of lockdown, they started going, and they most of them joined work from around 15th of May or 17th of May. So they have been denied of wages around 1.5 months. So you can imagine their plight. One, they are daily wage workers, they are living in so poor conditions. Most of them are in debt. They are not having ESI facility, they are not having EPF facility. Then also you are denying the wages to them. One more thing. As these are very poor people, in 10,000 or 15,000 rupees, what can they afford? Means they need also to take care of their food, food, clothing, medical care. So they live in very small shanties or jhuggis. In an area of 8 into 8 feet, around 4 or 5 people live. So there is, you can see that there will be no compliance of this social or physical distancing, what it is called. So the whole family or the whole society is at risk. They are not even provided the PCA. What happens that the permanent employees working in these hospitals get patient care allowance. Means an allowance in the for the case you get infected. Means you can take care of it by sanitization or by treatment. In the case you get infected by any kind of disease, in process of treating or in process of providing health services. But this class of employees don't get anything. So you can see that they are being denied most of the things. Condition of security guards is bit better. Bit better means they get around 15,000 rupees, not more. Although they are also not getting the minimum wage, scheduled wage. The minimum wages of security guards in Delhi, in central government hospital, is around 729 rupees. That's amount to around 21,000 rupees. At none of the places these people get. These people, the security guards, if you visit the central government hospital, these security guards do the work of hospital attendants also. They used to hold the prescriptions. They used to call the patients in the doctor's chamber, in the OPD chamber. So these workers, security guards also, are equally at risk. But they are getting EPF coverage, but there is also a fraud which is committed over there, that the proper deduction of EPF contribution is not being made. We saw a case in RML that the security guards had EPF account from last 15 years, but the contribution had not been deposited for around 8 to 9 years. You can imagine what the plight was. And what happened, the worker, the security guard got injured in an accident. So as he got in an accident, he was not putting to work, he was not able to earn. When he contacted our union, we tried to get advance on his PF by filling form 31. We saw that there was a whole scam in this whole healthcare system. Scam is going on. You cannot run any system by public private mode, public private partnership. The whole healthcare system need to be nationalized and public funded. One more thing.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Just one point. If I'm okay, fine. I have told you.
Okay. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Maybe fortunately I finished each and every one.
Okay. So no, thank you very much. I think you highlighted very well the link between informal employment and lapses in following protocols and providing the basic facilities that are required in the context of the current emergency, health emergency. And also very importantly, how then that can translate into transmission in the community where these workers live. So it's again, adding to the denial of rights that were already there, we have now this more complex situation that emerged. So thank you very much for this very informative presentation. I would like now to ask Jibin, who is Jibin, you're in Maharashtra, and that's probably currently one can say the eye of the storm of the COVID crisis. And there have been kind of mixed signals regarding the intention of this government of Maharashtra with regard to regulating the private sector. And you have a first-hand experience of what is and knowledge of what is going on. And what are the issues that especially nurses are facing in the private sector. So can you tell us a bit more of what is the situation now and what are the demands, and also, of course, a bit more broadly about nurses in public facilities also. What are the issues that are coming up, and how is the union able to put pressure on the government? Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Susanna, invitation, and I would like to highlight some of the issues what we are facing today in Maharashtra. You all know that in India, Maharashtra is the highest number we have right now. We have crossed almost 100,000 cases in Maharashtra, and we can see there are a lot of healthcare professionals also got infected for COVID-19. You know, as of today, there are more than 700 nurses itself have been tested positive because of COVID-19. So we found there are a lot of issues from the government side and from the management side where, you know, kind of negligence had happened during these 3 months' time. Since the time the corona was firstly came into India, we are seeing how the numbers were increasing and how different states been tackling the scenario. But I feel in Maharashtra, the government had, you know, complete failure to handle the scenario because there was improper management from the government sector. And there were no coordination among the healthcare professionals and to the public also. So every day the cases are increasing, and we have almost reached now 1 lakh cases. That is too much. And so what we observed in the initial time, where we were running short of PPE kits, I mean, the nurses were not getting adequate PPEs, not only the nurses, but also some other professionals. But comparatively, when it comes to hospital, nurses are the people who are into the front line majority of times. So those nurses were not given adequate PPE in the initial time. And we were in, you know, frequent contact with the hospitals and management to convince them to provide these nurses with the PPE kits and to make sure that these nurses are protected. But somehow it didn't work in the initial time because, you know, the hospitals also were not really keen and looking into this matter. So ultimately what happened, like many nurses got infected, then they realized the fact that the nurses should be given with PPEs and other facilities. So moving forward, the nurses were started getting PPEs, but even though that they were the second option for the management and for the government also. But now at least some hospitals, yes, they're providing PPE kits and nurses. That's a good thing. But when I look at the larger number of hospitals in Maharashtra, majority of them are still not giving PPE kits and the protective equipments like a N95 mask, 3-ply and all these things. So when I look at their accommodation facility, their transportation and the work timing, that's also so pathetic, because the nurses all stays in the accommodation provided by the hospital because it's an emergency service. So all of these nurses, I mean, majority of these nurses stays in the hospital premises itself or the accommodation being provided by the hospital. So that accommodation is like, you know, more than 10 people stay in a room where, you know, we need to follow this social distancing that's not been met in the hospitals. And the people who work in COVID department are staying with the people who are not working in COVID area. So there is a cross contamination happened always, and the numbers were increased day by day. From every hospital, we could see now more than 50 or more than 80 nurses itself is tested positive. That's because of improper management, or I could say it's a clear case of negligence from the management side. And when you look at that duty hours, it's like they make the nurses to work beyond 6 hours with PPE. Many of the hospitals work them, allowed them for 8 hours and 12 hours with PPE. That is inhuman thing, because, you know, wearing a PPE and work in a floor for at least four hours, that's something very difficult. So imagine a nurse is working with PPE for 12 hours, something unimaginable thing that almost all hospitals are insisting the nurses to perform. So we see a lot of incidents where nurses had issues with, you know, continuous work schedule because they get into trouble, they get in different issues, medical conditions, and some of them, you know, faint in the floor itself. And all this happened in a majority of this hospital. It might be in a public hospital or maybe in a private hospitals. So these things are happening today also. And we were trying to convince and we were trying to, communicate with the government in relation to all these issues. But ultimately, the government is not at all responding to any of our communication and any of our suggestions. You know, what we feel that the nurses are given no priority. That's what we can see here. Because all the decisions have been made by some other professionals, and there are no nurses involved in policy making or when it comes to a guidelines formation. So that's a main fault of a government. See, nurses are working 24/7 in the hospital setup, that too in the front line. So they would be the best people to address the issues pertaining to the hospital or pertaining to the patient. So, but when it comes to the state and even in the national wide, the nurses have not been called for any discussion or not been considered for any points or any policy making level. So that's what the government fails here to control this pandemic. Like my colleague were talking here about the community health care, how the ASHA workers are handling beautifully the community health. So similarly, the nurses are also a frontline warriors. They have a very good role in the health system wherein they can give you best input rather than any other personals. But here in the state, I could see no movement from the government side to support the nurses or to ask a nurse what should be done and how should we do it. These all questions are not coming from the government side, either from a state or from a central level. I see there are a lot of, you know, appreciation sometime from the different state or maybe sent from the central level, but you know, we don't record those appreciations because we are here to give our best care to the public, and we are there to do it, and we will be doing it even though if you don't get any appreciation. But what we require is a protection, and what we require a safe working environment, which is not here in the state at this moment of time. I see many nurses been tested positive because of the negligence, as I said earlier, and that could have been reduced. That number could have been reduced even if when we had a good system in the state, but I could not see that in the state at all. And top of that, you might have heard of there are three laws are into the place right now in Maharashtra state. One is the Epidemic Act, Pandemic Act, and top of that, the Maharashtra State Essential Service Act, which is MESMA, which is again targeting only the nursing and paramedical community. This is also a clear negligence and clear discrimination among this medical fraternity. So, on top of that, every corporation have come up with a new order saying that a nurse cannot, resign from her duty. Suppose if she get a better opportunity, if she wants to move out of the organization, she's not been given a permission. Now, many hospitals have running short of nurses. Why? Because the hospital always have attrition rate of 60% above. It is in a natural scenario, normal scenario. So all these nurses come, work there for maybe 1 year, 2 year time, and they try for better opportunities. Most of them try for abroad, I mean, out of India, because that's the only place where they get a good remuneration, good working condition, and after all, they get respected in the society. But here in India, we don't have that. So mostly these nurses go out of the state and they move to different part of the world. And that scenario is in Maharashtra also. You see 60% is attrition normally, but when it comes to COVID scenario, that 60% actually is reduced because nurses are putting more effort to help this patient in the state. That's a good sign. But still the hospital management are complaining that the nurses are not working. So I really don't understand why the management is so pathetic, so cruel way of behavior to the nurses. And also talking about the wages, they are not being paid the minimum wages. They just paid maybe 10,000 or 12,000, and some hospital pay them 6,000 to 8,000, which is very minimal, or I would say it is lesser than that. A person cannot survive with these kind of remuneration. And after all, you're staying in a city like a Mumbai and Pune where the expenses are so high. You need to have a basic salaries to stay in this stage. So that also is not happening. And many management keep a bond system. It means like when a nurse joins an organization, they take it in writing saying that the nurse would stay there for at least 2 years of time. So even if they want to leave before 2 years of time, they should pay a high compensation against this bond system. You know, we are aware of the bond system being demolished in the year of 2013, but still this is happening in the state of Maharashtra. I could see it in many parts in Maharashtra, especially from Mumbai and other places like Pune and Nagpur. So these are one of the major issues wherein nurses are facing right now. And if you look at their socio-economical and the stress level of nurses, it's too high these days. You know, you might have heard that one nurse committed suicide in Delhi because of she tested positive. It's just not that she tested positive. It is because of the other factor that she had a high level of stress, because the way management handling those nurses are very pathetic. That's the main reason. And if you look at current issues in Maharashtra, is like one is in private sector is a shortfall of nurses because they are not hiring nurses. They say that we do not have that funding right now, or we do not have that revenue to compensate them or to hire nurses. But that's not fact, I feel, because they were earning money like anything. I would say they were minting money like anything. I mean, the price in every hospital was too exorbitant. I mean, they were charging exorbitant charges to the patient, and now they claim we do not have the money to pay their own nurses. And also, I see whenever there is a nurse tested positive, you know, within the hospital, they try to send the nurse to a government facility where the hospital does not have to pay any amount. So all these nurses tested here in Maharashtra were sent to government facility. That means the government facility offered by the Bombay Municipal Corporation, which was so pathetic. It was like one place you have thousands of people lying together without any social distancing. And the nurses also were kept in that area. So there were no doctor visit, no treatment were given, and no food. So these were the pathetic condition of COVID care center in Maharashtra. So we tried our best to help out these nurses, and somehow it did well because of the pressure what we had. Also, you know, we don't really entertain the discrimination. So when I say the discrimination, it's like, you know, the nurses contribute the largest number of people in the healthcare system. Even though they're the largest in numbers, when it comes to any decision making, the nurses are not involved. Only the medical profession are being called for decision making, and they take a call on nurses' issues. And for them, it might not be a priority because they have their own, you know, issues to highlight and resolve the issues. But for them, nurses are least bothered. And when I look at the public healthcare system in India and in state itself, you know, if I look at the state healthcare, the nurses are not involved in anywhere. Only the medical professionals are there and politicians are there in the system. And even in our nursing council is being headed by a doctor. I mean, where a nurse supposed to be headed that designation, but unfortunately doctor is heading that, and he is also in charge for many other departments. For him, the nursing is might be a last priority. So majority of times, the communication to him with the nurses is lacking. And that's the reason the nurses are not being given any priority. And now another major issue, when the government is the government hospitals are facing a shortage of nursing staff. And the government is trying to get nurses from other states, because if they want to appoint nurses within the state, they would be having a high demand, or they would be having at least, you know, the pay should be at par with the government pay. But the government is not willing to pay even that amount also to the nurses. Now, you know, the government has come up with a contract employment and contractual employment also. Some hospitals some public hospital been given to a contractor, and the contractor will be appointing all these nurses to the hospital, and some area the government directly appoint, but only on contractual basis. Everywhere there is dissimilarity in the wage pattern. You know, starting from 10,000 to 30,000 is a maximum right now the Maharashtra government is offering, that too just for 3 months of time, which is very less. And you know, after 3 months, where are these nurses going to work? That is the biggest challenge and biggest question. So what we feel, this decision has been taken by the government is just to protect the interest of private hospitals. Because here, the government is so much protecting the private hospital management. That's what we can see it in these days. Because there are no control over these private organizations. Right now, even though the BMC, Bombay Municipal Corporation, have come up with the price controlling for the hospitals, like every bed need to be charged only a particular amount. But the hospitals are not following it at all. That's a pathetic scenario here in happening. If you want to get a bed in the hospital, you need to pay in lakhs of rupees. That also you need to, you know, deposit in their own bank in advance. So all these things are happening in the state of Maharashtra. So the government have decided to get some nurses from out of the state, where we have opposed, because we have adequate nurses in the state of Maharashtra itself, wherein our members have already enrolled, almost 3,600 nurses have already enrolled with us, who are willing to work in COVID care center given an opportunity. So we were in communication with the government. We have conveyed them, yes, we have adequate nurses to support the system. But still, the government does not want to hire these nurses. They always want to, you know, give it on contractual to some other state or to some other third party, wherein they can earn something out of it. It is also a money-making business for the government here. So looking at the private hospital scenario right now, they have a huge number of nursing shortage, wherein they are not appointing anybody, and they have very high working pattern, I mean very long duration working pattern, and the nurses are not given any facilities in the private organizations. And if I talk about their other privileges like EPF facilities, their bonuses or their medical insurances, nothing is there in the hospitals. And after all, the nurses are working in frontline, and they are most vulnerable people for, you know, encountering these kind of infectious diseases, but the government and management are least bothered. So that's a unacceptable thing. So what as a nurses we required from the government and from the private sector, we as a frontline workers, we as a frontline professionals, we need to get a basic facility to treat the patient. Ultimately, the benefit all goes to the patient, because for us the priority is patient. So to any extent might be in any difficult scenario, we as a nurses ready to work in might be a COVID center, it might be non-COVID center, it might be a long shift also, but we need to get minimum working schedule and we need to be paid well also to support our family. And looking at our current scenario, what we feel, there are a lot of things needs to be addressed, and we have learned a lot many things that I think I would share in later stage. With this, I'll wind it up right now. Okay. So thank you, Susanna. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, Jabin. I think it's very worrying to hear how, even in a context of a health emergency, it's really a free-for-all for the private sector in Maharashtra. And as it goes forward, this situation needs to be going worse. And that lack of interest of the government to step in and regulate and intervene to ensure that whatever it makes as pronouncement actually implemented on the ground. So that's something that we saw before the crisis, that attitude, and it really continues on. I would like now to request Dr. Adarsh, who is in the Ames Hospital. So there have been several protests in Ames over working conditions over the past few months. So can you tell us more about this protest, the underlying situation or conditions that have led to them, and of course the kind of resolution that you see for it? What are the demands? What are the steps that you think would be necessary to resolve the situation there?
Hello. So hello everyone, I'm Dr. Adarsh Pratap Singh from Ames. So basically apne desh mein jisme 1.4 billion population hai, wahan pe hamare yahan hospital ki capacities hi nahi hai, jab covid pandemic se pehle bhi, aur hamare paas healthcare professionals ki sankhya bhi kafi limited hai. Un sab ke chalte hue sarkar ne chronically, agar hum dekhenge, public health mein under investment hi raha hai. Over the time also public health को neglect ही रखा गया है. So इस समय जब COVID-19 pandemic की शुरुआत है, अभी भी हमने peak तक नहीं पहुंचे हैं, हमने ना ही plateau phase आया हमारा, उस समय ही हमारे healthcare professionals को बहुत सारे challenges का सामना करना पड़ रहा है. उसमें सबसे important जो है वो है safety and security of healthcare professionals. कोविड पैंडमिक स्टार्टिंग से ही हमारे हेल्थ केयर प्रोफेशनल्स को प्रॉपर सेफ्टी नहीं मिल पाई है, उनको प्रॉपर पीपी नहीं मिला है. पीपी जो मिलते थे सब स्टैंडर्ड होते थे, क्वांटिटी भी कम रही है लोगों पीपीई की. अपार्ट फ्रॉम पीपीई, हेल्थ केयर प्रोफेशनल्स को अप्रोप्रिएट एकोमोडेशन नहीं मिला है. दे हैज टू ट्रेवल फ्रॉम द फार अवे प्लेसेस फ्रॉम द हॉस्पिटल्स. एकोमोडेशन के साथ साथ उनका ट्रांसपोर्ट का इशू रहा है, क्योंकि कंप्लीट लॉकडाउन के समय उनको ट्रांसपोर्ट की बहुत ज्यादा प्रॉब्लम रही है. उसके साथ ही लगातार हम देख रहे हैं हेल्थ केयर प्रोफेशनल्स अक्रॉस द कंट्री, हम देखते हैं कि उन पे लगातार वायलेंस के केस आते रहते हैं, असॉल्ट के केस आते रहते हैं. कहीं ना कहीं ऐसे भी केसेस आए हैं जहां लोगों ने उनको, उनके जो मकान मालिक लोग थे, उनको उनको रहने नहीं दिया. उनको बोला कि आप यहाँ से जाइए, आप अस्पतालों में काम करते हैं, आपसे हमें कोरोना हो सकता है. तो ये जो डॉक्टर को सेफ्टी ना मिलना, वो अपने उनके लिए उनका मोरल डाउन होता है. उनका कोविड के समय जहां वो फ्रंटलाइन वॉरियर्स है, वो अपना 100% नहीं दे पाते हैं. इसके साथ ही साथ जब डॉक्टर लोग, ये तो उनकी सेफ्टी एंड सिक्योरिटी का इशू है. ओवर द टाइम अगर COVID-19 पैंडेमिक इतना डायनेमिक है, वी डोंट नो हाउ मेनी पेशेंट विल आर गोइंग टू कम इन द कमिंग मंथ्स. इतने डायनेमिक सिचुएशन में हमारे पास अप्रोप्रिएट नंबर ऑफ बेड्स नहीं है. मैकेनिकल वेंटिलेटर्स का प्रोविजन नहीं है हमारे पास। अगर हम पॉपुलेशन नंबर ऑफ बेड्स पर पॉपुलेशन देखें, हमारे 0.4 है, मतलब 0.4 नंबर ऑफ बेड पर 1000 ऑफ द पॉपुलेशन। इतने पुअर हेल्थ सिस्टम में इतना बड़ा COVID-19 पैंडेमिक हैंडल करना सारे ही हेल्थ के वर्कर्स के लिए काफी चैलेंजिंग है। इसके साथ ही हमें अभी एट दिस स्टेज आल्सो हमारे पास लोगों के लिए पर्याप्त मात्रा में बेड्स नहीं है। इवन मैकेनिकल वेंटिलेटर बेड्स तो मिल ही नहीं पा रहे हैं, नॉर्मल बेड भी मिलना बहुत मुश्किल हो रहा है। इसके लिए हमने रिपीटेडली जो एम्स में प्रोटेस्ट जो मेन चीजों पे रहे हैं वो डॉक्टरों की सेफ्टी के लिए रहा है, डॉक्टरों को प्रॉपर पीपी जो कि गुड अच्छी क्वालिटी का हो, उनके वर्किंग आवर्स को लेके रहे हैं। इसके लिए हमने कई बार होम मिनिस्टर प्राइम मिनिस्टर को चिट्ठियां भी लिखी हैं, बट उसमें बहुत ज्यादा हमें रिस्पॉन्स नहीं मिला है। इनकी जो मुख्य वजह है कि पब्लिक हेल्थ में अंडर इन्वेस्टमेंट रहा है, जहां बड़े बड़े देश जहां पे जीडीपी का 10-15% जो हेल्थ सिस्टम को प्रोवाइड होता है, वहां पे भी पैंडेमिक ने उनको भी इतना हिला दिया है। हमारे देश में जहां जीडीपी का 1.3% है पब्लिक हेल्थ के लिए, तो बहुत ही बड़ी प्रॉब्लम है, चैलेंजिंग है। हमेशा से हमारी डिमांड रही है कि पब्लिक हेल्थ में जीडीपी को बढ़ाया जाए। डॉक्टर्स और सभी हेल्थ केयर प्रोफेशनल्स की सेफ्टी अटमोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट है, उसके लिए हमने रिपीटेडली सेंट्रल प्रोटेक्शन एक्ट की डिमांड की है। एक्ट के साथ साथ ही जो वर्क प्लेस है वहां पे डॉक्टर सेफ फील करें, उनके लिए सिक्योरिटी गार्ड्स प्रोवाइड हों, उनको उनके जो इमरजेंसी एरिया है जहां पे यूजली लोगों के अंदर एग्रेशन भी होता है, उनको बाउंसर्स प्रोवाइड हों जिससे कि डॉक्टर्स लोग सेफ रहें। और हमने इस पिछले 3-4 महीने में जो ये चीज देखी है कि हेल्थ केयर का किस तरीके से मिसमैनेजमेंट हुआ है, लोगों की जो डिमांड्स थी हेल्थ केयर प्रोफेशनल्स को जो बेसिक नेसेसिटीज थे वो हम नहीं प्रोवाइड करवा पाए सरकार, बाकी मरीजों के लिए भी हम बेसिक चीजें नहीं प्रोवाइड कर पाए, हमने आइसोलेशन फैसिलिटीज को एक्सटेंड नहीं कर पाया। हॉस्पिटल की कैपेसिटी यू कैन नॉट क्रिएट इन ए स्मॉल टाइम पीरियड, बट यू हैव टू क्रिएट एक्सटेंशन ऑफ हॉस्पिटल्स। मेरा उसमें सजेशन हमेशा से यही रहा है कि आप स्कूल्स को आइसोलेशन सेंटर्स में कन्वर्ट करिए, जो रिलीजियस प्लेसेस है जहां ज्यादा स्पेसियस है उनको आइसोलेशन सेंटर्स बढ़ाइए। और अभी पैंडेमिक को देखते हुए हमें टेस्टिंग फैसिलिटी इंक्रीज करनी है। अभी हम टॉप 5 में पहुंच गए जहां पे नंबर ऑफ अगर कोविड की बात करें, लेकिन हमारी टेस्टिंग रेट अभी भी बहुत पीछे है। तो कंटेन करने के लिए अभी सबसे इंपॉर्टेंट है कि हमें टेस्टिंग अवेलेबिलिटी करानी है, वो हमें पर मिलियन पॉपुलेशन इंक्रीज करना है। इन सारी चीजों को मैनेजमेंट करने के लिए हम ओवर द इयर्स हम इंडियन मेडिकल सर्विसेज की डिमांड करी है हमने, जिसमें जो डॉक्टर्स हों, हेल्थ केयर प्रोफेशनल्स हों, जो लोग हेल्थ में काफी ट्रेंड है, इन्होंने ओवर द इयर्स उनका एक्सपीरियंस है, गाँव में काम किया है, शहरों में काम किया है, गवर्नमेंट हॉस्पिटल है, प्राइवेट हॉस्पिटल है, उन लोगों को एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव पोस्ट पे होना चाहिए, जिससे कि वो पूरा टर्सरी सेकेंडरी प्राइमरी हेल्थ केयर सिस्टम को अंडरस्टैंड कर सकें, उनकी ग्राउंड रूट लेवल पे क्या समस्या है उनको समझ सकें और उनपे टाइमली इंटरवेंशन प्रोवाइड कर सकें। तो इन सब चीजों के साथ ही अभी भी इस COVID-19 पैंडेमिक के दौरान भी हमारी सरकारें डॉक्टर को सम्मान के लिए ताली थाली फ्लावर्स ये सब चीजें कर रही है, बट अभी भी हमारे दिल्ली के अस्पतालों की ये हालत है कि वहां पे 4-4 महीनों से लोगों को सैलरी नहीं मिली है। तो आप ये कहां के कोविड वॉरियर्स, जब वो उनकी बेसिक नेसेसिटीज पूरी नहीं कर पा रहे हो तो उनका कैसे मोरल रहेगा, वो अपनी फैमिली को कैसे सपोर्ट करेंगे। तो बेसिकली अपार्ट फ्रॉम दैट एज ऑफ नाउ हमें हॉस्पिटल्स का एक्सटेंशन बढ़ाना है इन द फॉर्म ऑफ आइसोलेशन एरिया, जिससे कि हम इन्फेक्शन को कंटेन कर सकें, टेस्टिंग की रेट बढ़ानी है और सेफ्टी जो हेल्थ केयर प्रोफेशनल्स को हर लेवल पे प्रोवाइड कराना है, इसके लिए हमें सेंट्रल प्रोटेक्शन एक्ट लेके आना है। मैनेजमेंट अच्छा हो सके इसके लिए हमें इंडियन मेडिकल सर्विसेज को लेके आना है। ओवरऑल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर बढ़ाया जा सके हेल्थ केयर सिस्टम का, पब्लिक हेल्थ पे ज्यादा इन्वेस्टमेंट होना चाहिए, क्योंकि अगर आप देखेंगे पब्लिक हेल्थ को लोग एक्सेस 80% करते हैं जो कि 20% कंप्राइजेस है। अगर आप पब्लिक हॉस्पिटल्स देखेंगे जिनका परसेंटेज 20% है बट पॉपुलेशन जो है वो 80% एक्सेस करती है, तो सरकार को चाहिए पब्लिक हेल्थ केयर पे काफी ज्यादा इन्वेस्टमेंट करे, एटलीस्ट जीडीपी का 5-10%। सो दीज आर द बेसिक थिंग्स टू इम्प्रूव द हेल्थ केयर सिस्टम एज ए होल।
Thank you very much, Doctor. Do you want to tell us more also about the working condition? I mean, the protests. What was the root of the protests that happened, and how they got resolved? You want to leave that for later?
अभी हमारे यहाँ recently nurses union का protest हुआ था, nurses union का। उनकी demands थे कि 6 hours में PP के साथ 6 hours में काम करना बहुत ज़्यादा difficult है, genuine है, बट देर आर लाइक इस समय जहां हमारे पास लिमिटेड हेल्थ केयर प्रोफेशनल्स हैं ये फिजिबल नहीं था, तो एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन ने उनको अपार्ट फ्रॉम लाइक वर्किंग आवर्स बाकी फैसिलिटीज टाइमिंग फिक्स टाइमिंग के साथ उनको फ्रेश उनको बीच में रिफ्रेशनर्स वगैरह प्रोवाइड करके ये सब चीजें प्रोवाइड करके नाउ लाइक प्रोटेस्ट भी हो गया।
Thank you very much. I think you made the point very strongly of how the lack of facility, the neglect of the public health system is coming to bite. And you gave this number of 4 beds for 10,000 population. That is really, I think it really conveys the dearness of the situation. We have a few questions. One question is for all the speakers, which is that there are these different strata of labor within the healthcare system. Different working conditions exist. There are several unions within the different categories and between these categories. So the question is, what kind of solidarities exist between these unions, and maybe toward what other solidarities could be created? So if I can request all of you to reflect on that, and I'll start with the Comrade Sindhu, and maybe also Comrade Sidhu, if you could also speak a bit about the response that you have got from the state governments to the demands that you have posed to them. Do you feel that this moment of the COVID emergency is allowing for doors to open in terms of creating more dialogue with the government, or is it even more tightly closed than usual? So if you could start. Thank you.
See, about the unions are concerned, I think that more than 40 categories are there within the hospital itself. I think so. Our health sector comrades can respond to that. There are efforts because many places in the unionization is very difficult, particularly in the private sector and all. So whatever limited unions are there, we are having coordination, particularly those who are affiliated with the central trade unions. We have joined actions and all also, and others also. We always organize solidarity actions like the struggles of the UNA or other nurses and private sector struggles also. But now the need of the hour is that more coordination and more joined movement. It's not only for our health conditions, that means our working conditions, but also for the stronger public health care and the right for health services for the people. Because when it is more and more commercialized and this health service is termed as health industry and means this what is called health tourism and all these things are coming. So that is very much necessary. I think that about the state governments, it is very clear that all this entire package and all, I think that the annuation can organize another set of seminar on the entire state-center relations, and it's going to be an autocratic and authoritarian regime. Means using this entire pandemic situation to impose these essential services and all this disaster management act, and it is entire power and the entire resources are more and more centralized, and the states are not given any kind of right to even to spend, even their dues, even in the GST and all, are not given. And it's not to say about any additional help. It is there, what they were telling is that around 7,000 crores or so, something like that only. 4,500 crores for the health sector improvement to the states. So it is all totally passed on to the states. Okay, these are all the guidelines you do. That is situation which vis-a-vis the center and state government is concerned. So it is very important that we build pressure on the role of the central government, because the resources are there. And you can see that 69,000 rupees, I think, crore, 69,000 crore was the budget allocation for the entire health sector last year, I think Susanna can sell. And 68,000 crores last year was written off from this Mehul Choksi and this Nirav Modi and company. They 50 people, for 50 people, 68,000 crores have been written off. This is the kind of policy where without discussing that, we cannot discuss the working condition and the entire health sector issues. And here, think that one, some of the issues we have to highlight, and we have to have more and more joint kind of activities for the things and about the wage, working conditions and all. And now at present, it has to be in the highlight of all the debates that the safety of the frontline workers, particularly the health sector workers.
Thank you very much. Yes, so this importance to look at the health system as a whole system, that can, and within that we can bring all the unions together.
Oh, sorry, Susanna, you asked about the response of the state governments. I missed that point. Yes, we had, even during this pandemic, even earlier, you know that even the ASHA workers are not getting any permanent kind of wage structure. In some of the states, due to our struggles, we could get in Andhra Pradesh, we are getting, ASHA workers are getting rupees 10,000 per month. And in Telangana, 7,500, Kerala, we are having, and Haryana and all. This is even pre-pandemic. And even during the pandemic, even in Karnataka, in Andhra, most of the states, this 50 lakh insurance the government has declared that they will get. And many cases, they only through the struggles they got. And in additional payment from the state government also, many of the unions, they could get additional payment for the COVID duty during this period itself. And some kind of allowances or festival, means that kind of additional allowances also some of the states they got. Even in district based, like our Indore was, you know, that this the kind of a hub red zone, and where most of the cases came in Madhya Pradesh. There, the ASHA workers had an agitation, they had a strike because they were also getting infected and there was no safety. And the district magistrate, the district collector, he arranged for additional payment of remuneration, monthly payment through some Red Cross or something like that. This is for the period of this COVID and this pandemic. That kind of a bargaining power also is there. That question also, I think that about the kind of essential service and the right to even go for a strike, means that also now the attack is on that, the labor rights, as the workers, that right also is being taken away. Now everything is as under disaster management, no minimum wage, no social security. Means all these rights of the workers are put on pending, or it is being freezed by many of the state government also.
Thank you. Yes, a kind of a mixed situation where there are some possibilities for entry points at certain levels, and at the same time, by pushback from the state, that is to be expected. I will request also Comrade Surya to respond to the same question about the existing solidarities that exist and those that would be required. And there is an additional question also of what can be the demands that can bring all healthcare workers together to fight for common rights. If you could also address this question.
See, I will tell the diagnosis and the solution. Okay. And see, there are three class of employees, means on the basis of contract, permanent or contractual, three class of employees are there in every hospital. One is permanent employee, second is contractual employee, third is contract employee. Contractual means there is no middleman, there is no contractor between the management and the employee. They are directly under the management. Third class of employee is the contract employee. Means it is through the third party, it is through a contractor. And this class of employee is highest in number. And contract plus contractual amounts to around 70% of the manpower in these hospitals. So thing is that we had a meeting in Jabalpur of the health care workers confederation. There we took a resolution that we need to unite these contract workers on a massive scale. See, because they from last several years, 20 years or 25 years, there hasn't been any big hiring of recruitment of permanent employees. From last 20 to 25 years, contractual or contract employees are working in the hospital. So the number of permanent employees is diminishing. So how? So once the permanent employee is less in number, their union cannot have any bigger say in the management. They don't have the bargaining power with the management. So how can you bargain with the management or with the government? You need numbers. So for needing numbers, you need to bring these contract or contractual employees in your fold. So first and foremost, means solidarity kind of thing is that, see, it is a bit difficult due to means class contradictions and such kind of things that means a tendency is that doctors are not, means they are not very aware, they are not bothered about the issues of the contract employees, means sanitation worker, means that's a separate issue. But thing is that you can have means bigger kind of movement very to transform the whole healthcare from these contract employees. See, generally is that the permanent workers are not mentioned these days. The contract employees, the basically fourth grade employees, can be unionized on the pan India level, and a different kind of movement can be built up. And that will also transform the healthcare sector, and that will also transform the society. Means once you change the healthcare, society will transform, and the worker who are very minimally paid, they are they are being denied the social security and the statutory rights, they will also be empowered financially and socially. So, and see, healthcare education is a sector which employs the maximum number of people in organized sector. Okay, so, and it will go in perpetuity. Till the time the human civilization is there, healthcare and education will be there. There is no significant change is going to be in this delivery mechanism. So delivery mechanism can be different, transport or any other sector, but this healthcare and education, nothing can change substantially. So once you unionize these fourth class employees, means fourth class, third class employee, means a very necessary chunk, a bigger movement can be brought, and some bigger changes can be brought in the system. Anything else, Suna?
Thank you very much. I think that importance of uniting across employment conditions that are so important to understand what the working conditions are, and the permanent workers being one category, fixed term workers that you're calling contractual, contract workers which are through third parties, and interestingly, I guess Sindhu can tell us, there is a fourth category of the scheme workers that are actually not even fitting within these three.
To
bring all of them together. We can now ask Jibin, whose camera is seems not to be working. Jibin, can you hear us? So I'm not sure that Jibin can hear us. So maybe we'll go directly to Adarsh. Dr. Adarsh, are you there also?
Yeah.
Yes, okay. So if we can also have your views on the existing alliances, the existing solidarities and those that are required. And maybe also if you can speak about the relationship between permanent and non-permanent workers that you can see in the AIIMS hospital, the dynamics there, that would also be useful. How do we bring them together? What are the demands that bring them together was one of the questions.
Basically, सबसे important है कि हमें public health system को strengthen करना है, उसमें हमें सारे unions को एक साथ लेके आना है, और public health पे जहां investment बढ़ेगा, privatization को इतना promote नहीं करना है, किसी भी country में आप देख लो, health system को अगर हम देखें, privatization से कभी अगर आप देखेंगे, middle class, lower class, they are highly affected, so हमें बेसिकली पब्लिक हेल्थ सिस्टम को प्रमोट करना है, प्राइवेटाइजेशन को प्रमोट नहीं करना है. जब हम प्राइवेटाइजेशन को प्रमोट नहीं करेंगे, पब्लिक हेल्थ को करेंगे, पब्लिक डोमेन में लोगों को फैसिलिटीज और सारी यूनियन उस चीज के लिए एक साथ आके लड़ना होगा, जिससे कि पब्लिक हेल्थ में लोगों का एक्सप्लॉयटेशन इतना नहीं है कंपेरेटिवली इन द प्राइवेट हॉस्पिटल्स. सो वी हैव टू कम ऑल टूगेदर, ऑल यूनियंस टू फाइट for the public health investment, where we can avoid the exploitation by the managers, by the higher authorities, and we will be able to have our basic facilities will be available there.
Thank you very much. I'm trying to see if we can get Jibin. There is a question related to this private sector, but I don't think he can hear us.
Sorry, Susan, I had a power failure.
Okay, we are there.
Yeah, I'm back.
Okay, great. So, Jibin, there is a question that has been asked to all about the existing solidarities, those that are required. There is an additional question specifically about the private sector. And the large level of contractualization that is seen in the private sector. Right. So how do you work around those issues? What is the actual situation with contractualization, if you can also tell us? And then linked to this, I think we heard about how the government of Tamil Nadu hired a large amount of health workers on a permanent basis.
Yes.
But clearly in Maharashtra, the government is not thinking of doing the same. And even in public sector, it is looking at short-term, 3 months contract, and going through third-party agencies. So can you tell us what do you think is the thinking in the government of Maharashtra to go for that? And you know, are there openings to try? Do you think it is doable to do in the same way that the government of Tamil Nadu did?
Right. So that's a good question, because you know, we have to really think on this matter, because looking at the solidarity among the union, that's most important in this thing. So what I feel here, I mean, today in Maharashtra, what we're doing, we are in collaboration with other unions for a common cause. Like you said one thing, how do all the union comes together for a common cause, right? So in that case, what we are highlighting right now in Maharashtra, there are around 32,000 nursing vacancies are there in the state. Okay, that's a huge number. So the government is not trying to fill this these vacancies with permanency. They all want to appoint nurses as into a contract employment or contractual employment, which all unions are against putting their pressure. So we all unions are in a common way right now to pressurize the government to employ these nurses into a permanency. As we have already rightly you said, Tamil Nadu have that example because they have appointed more than 1,300 nurses. I mean, within the state of Tamil Nadu in a permanent basis. So looking at Maharashtra, looking at the budget of Maharashtra, definitely the government of Maharashtra can appoint these many nurses and other healthcare professionals. That's not a toughest job for them. But just to protect the interest of private institutions, the government is not taking an initiative, nor they're showing any support to the nurses. But I feel, you know, when all the union comes together, I mean, all the healthcare union comes together, definitely this can be achievable without any doubt. That's my intention, and definitely we can do that, I believe. Thank you.
Thank you, Jibin. We have one more question, which I would like to pose to everyone, and also add one more for everyone to respond and I guess give the closing remarks. The question that has come is about how there is a large part of the beds in the Indian system that are in the private sector, estimates to 70 to 80%, and it has been seen how the private sector has been unable to respond in some places. It has denied access to care for COVID-19 patients, turned them away. Those that are treating COVID patients are charging extremely high prices. On the side of healthcare workers also, we can see how the working conditions are really bad there. Do you think that these fault lines in the system have the potential to create a movement for universal and free healthcare in India? And if you can also reflect on what do you think are the learnings from this period of the crisis for the changes that are required on the long term? So both in terms of concretely, what are the things that need to change, and what is the opportunity here for a broad-based movement for universal and free healthcare system? So I'm going to ask people to respond in the opposite order. So if we can start with Dr. Adarsh.
So basically, many initially also I told that 70 to 80% jo health system hai, jo log hai, the people are dependent on the पब्लिक हेल्थ सिस्टम ओनली, जबकि पब्लिक हेल्थ सिस्टम कंप्राइजेज ऑफ 20% ओनली. तो ये रेशियो 80-20 का है. वी हैव टू चेंज दिस रेशियो. वी हैव टू प्रमोट द पब्लिक हेल्थ सिस्टम, सो विच इज अटमोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट, क्योंकि हमारे यहाँ जो क्लास है लोगों का, मोस्टली लोग जो है वो मिडिल एंड द लोअर क्लास में है. सो वी हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड देयर प्रॉब्लम्स एंड दे कैन नॉट अफोर्ड द प्राइवेट केयर. So we have to promote the private, we have to promote the public health system in terms of increasing the hospital capacity, in terms of providing the security healthcare workers and providing them permanent jobs in the government hospitals. So what we have COVID-19 pandemic still is on in our country. So बेसिकली जो हमने मुख्य रूप से सीखा है वो ये है कि इतने बड़े देश में वी आर नॉट हैव इनफ कैपेसिटी टू हैंडल आर लार्ज पॉपुलेशन. पब्लिक हेल्थ हैज बीन अंडर इन्वेस्टेड ओवर द इयर्स. वी हैव टू टेक ए नोट ऑफ इट. फ्रॉम नाउ ऑनवर्ड्स वी हैव टू फोकस ऑन द पब्लिक हेल्थ. वी हैव टू इंक्रीज आवर हॉस्पिटल कैपेसिटी, इंक्रीज द ह्यूमन रिसोर्सेज in terms of healthcare professionals, because these kinds of challenges we want to be able to handle if we do not focus on these things. And one and most important thing in our country is safety and security of healthcare workers. If you see over the years, over the month, even in the lockdown also, we will see the assault and the violence on the healthcare professionals have increased also. So this is very threatening condition in our country. So we have to take over all these things and we have to focus on the public health system with the safety and security to all the healthcare professionals.
Thank you very much. Yes, I guess we are now in a situation where we know what happens with this kind of health system. And this is probably not the last time that we see a health emergency. So we need to be prepared for the next one too. Jibin?
So for me, I think we need to more focus on public healthcare system, especially we should be more focused on the private the community healthcare centers, and that is the one area where we need to focus, because rural people have lesser accessibility to the healthcare facilities comparatively with the metro cities and the tier 1 and tier 2 cities. because there the people are not being given adequate support from the government side, and they cannot afford the private facilities. So I think more we'll have to focus in the community healthcare centers or community healthcare and preventive healthcare. That should be one area we need to focus. And looking at the other hospital, like public healthcare setup, yes, of course, the standardization has to be improved, because you know, if you ask me, like, would you prefer a public hospital? I would not, because looking at the scenario in the public hospital, looking at the conditions of the public hospital, it is pathetic, because they do not have any facilities. The quality of care is lacking, and the manpower is in very, very big shortage. And look at the equipment and the disposable, whatever provided in the public healthcare system is below average quality. Even though we have got different standardization and we have got the FDA, Food and Drug Administration, to control all these things, but still our country is not controlling all this private sector. I mean, all this, you know, medical companies, pharmaceutical companies, all are, you know, investing a lot into private healthcare, but not into public healthcare system. So we need to improve the standardization of standard of this public hospitals to attract the people to opt for a public hospital. That should be one motive, so that in future, the people should opt a public hospital rather than going to a private hospital. That should be the motive.
Yes, I think there is a lot of discussion about the perception also of how the private sector perceived to be such a good system, and the public is also been spoken about always in these negative terms. Probably it's a bit more mixed bag, because we know that there are so many unethical practices going on in the private sector that doesn't make for good care. And some of our leading institutions, like the AIIMS, is a public institution. And the quality of care is, of course, in a difficult situation, considering that it's been neglected and it's really overstretched. But yes, we need to kind of discuss these narratives about, you know, the quality and how they present themselves in both systems. Just a follow-up question to you, Jibin, because this question has come now of, have there been more organizing during the COVID-19 period? Because there is an impression that I think the people who have been watching the webinar are getting and have been seen around them. So maybe if you want to give a short response to that.
Yes, we see it in our profession, because when it comes to nurses, we have not seen these kind of moment earlier, because we are the one people who are unregulated or unorganized sector is nursing sector. So we were not having that high influence in the unions, or we were not being educated in that level. So now I can see a lot of unions are coming up, and they are actually putting the effort to resolve these issues pertaining to the hospitals and nursing profession. So that's a good sign, and definitely this will have a good impact on the public health sector also, because looking at in a vast level, we see national wide, the unions are very active, especially in our cases, because the nurses are the one who are facing much difficulty in this scenario due to this crisis. So that's a good thing anyway.
Thank you. So some organizing is indeed really happening in the private sector.
And we see there are new members coming and joining us also. It's a voluntary joining to the union. That also we are seeing these days.
That's very good to know. Comrade Surya?
Yeah. See, basically, I think your question was whether the fault line which developed during this COVID crisis is going to lead the utilization or means some kind of mobilization in the health sector or not, and whether that will lead to change in the healthcare structure or not. I think these are your question.
Yes. How can it become? How do we make it happen like this?
Yeah, see, basically, I'm not a healthcare worker, I'm basically an organizer. So I can give my views on that. See, the fault line and the contradiction which have developed, that is positive. I would, as a Marxist, I would say that is a very positive development. Means the system has already broken, But this COVID crisis has exposed that. Now, nothing is behind the curtain. So, everywhere means we were in process, we were in talk with lot of means healthcare employees. Earlier means they were having bit apprehensive kind of approach. They were bit means lagging. They were not very eager to join unions. But now COVID crisis has given us means a way, a channel to contact them. And other thing, earlier the common masses had a perception that they can means purchase healthcare through money. But this COVID crisis has shown that now they cannot purchase means any, even a upper middle class person can also not be sure that he can means pay for medical facilities in a five-star hospital. Until unless he doesn't have any insurance or some very means a big inheritance or some kind of fortune, he cannot afford to pay. So there is a perception among means the middle class, which is the biggest supporter of this government and such kind of means. So that I think there is a perception among us that no, healthcare and education must be public funded. So I think this fault line is very important. I think that's a silver lining. We can make inroads in the means trade union field also. We can make inroads electorally also to have contact with larger number of masses on this issue itself. That see, there is a fault line. See, you cannot go to the government hospitals as they do not have beds, and you cannot afford private hospitals as they are charging too exorbitantly. So what's the solution? We can ask this question, and we can always say that, see, presently, where do the politicians go? The politicians go to the public funded hospital. Either they go to the AIIMS, either they go to the RML. These are not means private institutions. These are public funded institutions. So what is that? You need to go with a proper plan. Like means you need to have proper setup of primary healthcare, tertiary, secondary healthcare, tertiary means referral kind of healthcare. You need to go with a proper plan to the public, to the employee. You need to make them aware what the possibilities are. I think it's a long and arduous journey, but I think it would be worth treading. If we work on this, I think there will be a revolution in this social structure and healthcare system. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So really an opportunity that we can see in this very difficult situation. And again, a positive sign that organizing is also, this is also an opportunity for organizing that unions are taking. Comrade Sindhu, you have the last word. You can respond to the different questions from the possibility of this broad-based movement and also the question about organizing. And your closing remarks.
Actually, this pandemic has, as Surya has said, that it has exposed the entire system. And particularly the in the health sector, it is very visible because the entire private sector has totally failed, or they are unable to do anything. And even the public perception, even the not only the upper middle class, even the elite class also is in a panic of these how to, means if they get infected, what to do. So this is there is a contrast. And even in India, fortunately, at least we are having this what we call the Kerala model. So what a public healthcare system and a sensitive government can do. So that also is helpful for bringing a model. Okay, this is even within the system, this can be done. So this is one thing which I think that we need to project for the entire demand of this public universal and free healthcare system. That should be a demand of the people, and without that demand, this entire problems of the healthcare system workers cannot be addressed. So there, the government is trying to project this insurance based kind of healthcare system, So we have to oppose that. At least that is that the people are subsidizing that system, that we are paying for that insurance-based system. So that is totally not feasible. And like in Kerala, the public health care system has to be strengthened, and for that more allocation and for more strengthening of the total system, that has to be one of the foremost demands. And this pandemic has given a possibility to bring such kind of a demand from the public. It is coming. Means it's a natural thing that where is the system. And it is giving us also an opportunity to advocate more for that. So then there in within that system, these crucial questions. Earlier what we our there is a question that the unions are becoming more visible, because this earlier now you cannot have any discussion of the much of, because nothing much is happening in the film industry except the stars are cooking and all. So people, even the media is forced to discuss about the frontline warriors and what they are doing, what are their demands, and it is coming up, and people, they are also dying. So this is a crucial situation where this is more visible. They are coming, and people are also getting, like Jibin said, that they themselves are becoming aware of their own issues and coming as class conscious to coming for unionization. That is this pandemic has brought such a situation also. Similar is the case with the migrant laborers. Even the migrant laborers who were very reluctant to getting unionized, now people, because the trade unions were the first and foremost to address and help them. And it is the people who were helping them, not none of the governments. So there they realize that, and they are coming also ready to get unionized. This is also a possibility of people coming for their own rights and for a better society. So this is a chance, and there this crucial question of the entire healthcare and de-glorifying the entire health sector workers, that the nightingales and all these things and corona warriors, all these flowers and all these things has to be, and people said that we don't want any more flowers or any more that thing, that we want our wages, we want our protective equipments. This kind of a system has to be. So there the question of their wage and the recognition of the workers and their social security and all the safety has to be discussed, and that can be focused. So there the entire health system, one positive thing is happening, that all these categories of workers, because there within there also the social stigmas, contradictions and all these things are there. The nurses will not care for the class 4 employees, or the doctors don't care for the others. That kind of a situation was there. Now everybody together is fighting for the humanity, and there that kind of a solidarity also is emerging. So that's also a positive thing. There this possibility is asking for the right of the workers. So especially the scheme workers, the ASHA workers, they are most crucial. Make it permanent system, public health system, and also the contract workers. Permanent kind of work, you need the cleaning staff, you need the lab technician, you need all these people. So make them permanent, have a permanent system, whether it is in private or in public, they have to be made permanent, that there should be wages. There's no kind of a glorified thing of honorarium or anything. So pay them wages. They are workers. We need that thing. So need our social security minimum wages. This kind has to be highlighted. So there, and then this, I think that one more thing about the social stigmas, that also, because even the doctors, they are not allowed to go to their apartments. Because they are also considered as corona carriers. So it's not only about the ASHA workers or the Safai Karmacharis. So entire, and then what is the ministers and or are doing even? They are totally means promoting these kind of Gomutra and Pujas and all these things. There is nothing about any scientific approach. And demystifying all these diseases and educate people, that also, that I think that our health sector and the trade unions and the common workers organizations are having a major role in demystifying all these diseases and to put the scientific attitude also. So this, I think that in this situation, it has to be a movement. It has to be, and because other means, as our people were telling, that there is a demand from the central trade unions and which is supported by the percent organizations and other sectors of women and students and youth, and everybody is supporting. And in that, one is the one demand is for the universal free healthcare, and also they are supporting the demands of the healthcare system workers of their safety and their working conditions. So this is a positive thing, and in the coming days it is bound to happen, because people are really dying. They are out of hunger also. The food and health, these both are going to become the foremost issue, and the people are already on the streets. People are demanding. Even in spite of the lockdown, the migrant workers were on the street. In spite of your asthma, even in Madhya Pradesh, where all the labor laws were banned, there even the ASHA workers and the Safai Karmacharis, they are also on the strike, and they got their demands also. The system was forced to admit for that. So that kind of a power is there. So in the coming days, and this was reflected in our own, I said about the 14th May thing, and there was 22nd of May, the Central Trade Union's protest was there. That was also responded with by everybody, and even common people were supporting that. And even in the coming days, on the 3rd of July, the Central Trade Unions has given a poll for protest on the demands of the common people. And one of the foremost demand is the safety for the health sector workers, and also, and including the ASHA workers and the NHM workers and even the doctors and all the frontline workers, including the police. So that is, safety is must, and their working condition, improving their working condition, that also is a demand on 3rd of July. And as I said, that on 25th of June, we are given a call on ASHA workers, All India Coordination Committee, and we are requesting all the health sector people, that highlighting the health sector before the 3rd of July common joint struggle, to have focusing on this and for the public health. We are demanding at least 5% of the GDP to be provided for the public health system. As all our panelists said, we all are together, and I hope in the coming days the people's movement will be forcing this government to care for the people.
Thank you very much, Comrade Sindhu. Yes.
It's a small thing that I will appeal the whoever is listening this, that to make the call of all central unions for general strike on 3rd of July to successful wherever you are, just spread the word. Whoever is listening, I just want to communicate this from my side. Okay, Sujana, please hand over to you.
Yes, thanks a lot. I think we can, it's a very good note to end, to look at how, despite the challenges and the adverse context, we're in a situation where we can observe that the demands of workers have been made visible in this context, that there is a certain amount of consciousness of workers, and that is translating also into willingness to join unions, so strengthening of unions, and how the fault lines of the system have been exposed. And these coming together can really help for a demand for public health once and for all. And this is also an agenda that the organization I work with, Public Services International, is working on with the unions that are affiliates, and we look forward also to work with all of you on this. So with this, I would like to thank all the speakers and thank Anveshan. There is, I think, a few words that the host also wants to say. So again, thanks everyone, and I give it back to the Anveshan team for the closing remarks.
Yeah, thank you so much, Sujana. I think it was an excellent talk. It was a very comprehensive talk, and I really hope that by the means of such talks, we can actually call out the hollow attempts on the part of the state to create this narrative by which healthcare workers are glorified, but at the same time, their voices are repressed. And not just that, but I also hope that such programs can also manifest into a larger movement. So, I think it was an excellent talk. So, on behalf of Anveshan, I'd like to thank the participants for taking out time for this. And I also want to thank the speakers, Comrade Sindhu, Dr. Adarsh, Comrade Surya, and Jibin, and also Sujana, for making time for this. And I really hope that you can follow us on our Facebook page and on our YouTube channel. We'll upload the recording of this talk there. And also, I would like to apologize for the inconvenience that was caused in the beginning of the talk. So, I mean, the fact that someone disrupted it was reflective of how important it is for us to raise our voices. And I really hope that we continue to raise our voices against the oppression, the sponsored oppression of the state. So once again, thank you so much for being here with us today. Thank you.